Welcome to CIO Leadership Live, Women in Technology. I'm Lee Rennick, Executive Director of CIO Communities for CIO.com, and I'm very excited to introduce and welcome Elizabeth Akorita, Group Deputy Director, Digital Delivery, Department for Science and Innovation, and Technology and Department for Energy, Security, and Net Zero. That is a huge job and a huge responsibility. Thanks so much for joining us here today, Elizabeth. Could you please introduce yourself and maybe tell us a little bit about your current role?
I'm Elizabeth Akorita, and I lead a digital delivery team for a shared service within UK government. I oversee the development and implementation of user-friendly digital tools that support a wide range of government departments. My team focuses on both internal services that are used by government staff and external services that are used by the public. Ultimately, our goal is to use technology to solve real problems for real people.
It's a huge remit. It was such an honor to speak with you a little while back just about your role, and I'm really excited for this interview today, Elizabeth. I mean, we really created the series to support diversity in technology, really to listen to women who are working in the sector, you know, who are building out and supporting DE&I. This year, International Women's Day theme was to embrace equity. I'm getting goosebumps talking about it and talking with you because it's so inspirational. So, I mean, the first question I ask everyone is, you know, can you please tell us perhaps about your own career path, maybe provide some tips on that road path, especially as a woman? Are there any lessons learned that you could share with our audience?
Sure thing. So I will say that my journey into technology hasn't been entirely linear. I actually started out in science communications, where I discovered the power of clear and engaging storytelling. This foundation came in handy when I moved into technology, driven by its potential to solve real problems and make a difference in people's lives. My background lets me bridge that gap between the intricate technical side and the empathetic human side of innovation. And as a woman in tech, there are a couple of key pieces of advice that I would give to anyone looking to get into this field. Firstly, I would say align your passion with your purpose. Identify what excites you and find a role that lets you use your strengths and contribute to something meaningful. Embrace continuous learning. The tech industry is constantly evolving, so be open to learning new skills and staying up to date with the latest trends. I would encourage people to build their network, surrounding themselves with supportive people, both within their organization and through external communities. And mentors and sponsors can be invaluable resources for guidance and advocacy. Lastly, I'd say don't be afraid to step outside your comfort zone. That's where I've found my most growth as a leader. I would encourage people to challenge themselves and embrace opportunities to learn and grow, even if those opportunities seem very daunting at first.
Wow. Those are really amazing and very informative tips. Thank you so much for sharing that. I mean, it is a very different road path we take as women, you know, in learning about our careers and learning how to navigate that. So that is very special. Thank you for sharing that. I really, really appreciate that. When we chatted a few weeks ago, and you mentioned this already, you've really built this huge shared services model with 13 organizations, over 17,000 employees and users, you know, that work together under this platform in the UK government. It's a huge undertaking. Congratulations. I'm really looking forward to learning more about that. So maybe could you talk a little bit about that transformation and the skills as a leader and strategies you use to build out the project? Are there any tips on change management delivery as well you could share or talk about?
Yes, sure thing. So I will stop by saying it was a team effort. There were a lot of people's efforts that went into getting us to where we are today, so credit where it's due. I will say that the development of a shared service model spans two ministerial, so that's central pieces of government, which is an umbrella that encompasses 13 government organisations. And the service provides digital tools for, as you said, about 17,500 staff, up from a baseline of 12,000 before we went into the service. And we build digital services also for tens of millions of citizens throughout the UK as part of our gov.uk platform. It was a challenging but rewarding experience. So there are a couple of key aspects of the transformation and the skills that I use that I'm happy to share with you today. Firstly, I would say, as I said, it's a team effort, so collaboration and focusing on the people side of change would be my number one tip. Building trust and achieving buy-in from all stakeholders is absolutely crucial. We actively engage with representatives from each of the different bits of government throughout the process to understand their specific needs for individual and team level and ensure that a shared approach would really work for them and address them effectively. Next, communication. That's a key part of any change management. You need to be repeating your messages until you're blue in the face. If you're not sick of yourself repeating those messages, you're probably not repeating them often enough. So we had clear and transparent communication throughout the project. This included regular updates throughout the project, status updates, explanations of the benefits from the user's point of view, and open channels for feedback and questions so that user needs would be kept on a continuous loop. We looked at proper change management hygiene. We recognized that transitioning to a new system would require adjustments for everyone. We implemented a comprehensive change management plan with training, resources, support documentation, clear communication to help people move from one state to another. Lastly, as I've said a few times, but the focus really is on people. The technology part is always the easiest part of any transformation, so focus on your people. Our team's skills and expertise were paramount to this project's success. We invested in training and development programs to ensure that our teams had the knowledge and capabilities to support this new platform and effectively assist users from all bits of government to move from one state of being to another.
It's really huge. And when you talk about communication and then, you know, exploring the benefits with the end user and then, you know, training up everybody and having those clear guidelines, that just seems like such an important part of it. When we chatted last time, I mentioned that I had hosted a roundtable with some individuals who had started shared services in our government in Canada. And they were really getting, you know, varied feedback from the people around the table about the work. So everything you've outlined here seems so sounds like overall you just had such an overarching strategy. And I'm assuming you had buy-in from all of the departments and areas you were working first to build that out. And it sounds like you involved on the communication part, maybe other areas of the business, maybe a marketing arm or a communications arm or something like that. So really just sounds like such a great, successful project. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. So I wanted to, this kind of builds on that last question, because we did chat about this earlier. I wanted to talk about leadership around scaling digital governance through people and culture. You know, could you talk a little bit about your approach to building teams, building culture, performance, you know, through leadership?
So I believe that strong leadership is ultimately about empowering and inspiring people. And that's especially true as you become more senior and therefore the people underneath you are quite senior as well. So key aspects of my approach that contribute to building successful teams and positive culture include a few elements. Firstly, as I've said, empowerment. I trust team members and provide them with the autonomy to take ownership of their projects and make decisions. This creates a sense of either shared or individual responsibility, accountability, and ownership as appropriate. I seek to build trust through transparency, approachability, and being supportive. I strive to create an environment where people feel comfortable sharing ideas, even silly ideas. We like to say there are no silly ideas. Every idea is a good idea.
Yeah.
Encourage people to ask questions, create an environment where people feel safe making mistakes or admitting failure, because there's always growth and learning in that, especially people fail quickly and have a learning mindset. Speaking of which, there's a culture of learning as well that's really critical to the teams that I run. I believe in fostering a culture of continuous learning where everyone is encouraged to develop their skills and stay up to date on the latest trends. This allows us to adapt and thrive in an ever-changing environment where no 2 weeks are the same. Lastly, I focus on results. So I've talked a lot about the people and the empathetic and the kind of softer skill side, but there is also a more traditional side there where you really need to set clear goals, hold myself accountable, hold the team accountable for achieving specific results. We track progress, we celebrate achievements, we actually have an annual celebration where we reflect back on all the great things we've done in the year to help keep everyone motivated and focused on delivering value.
That is fantastic. And it aligns well. I hosted a panel. We had a future IT conference here in Toronto last week. And one of my panelists, Renata Kunin, who's VP of Global Tech, I believe, at Canada Life, she was talking about, you know, very similar ways in which to approach leadership. And one of the things she said, which I think was really interesting, and you referred to it as creating a safe space to connect and talk. And she said, you know, I tell my team, like, if you don't like what I'm saying, tell me, right? Like, just tell me, because if it doesn't align with our overall strategy, or you have a different opinion or a different idea of where we could take it. But I love this idea of this celebration you do too. I'd like to be invited to one if possible. I'd love to see that in action. It must be so great.
Yes, absolutely. It's wonderful. Everyone, one thing I will say is that everyone gets involved in those celebrations. So there's government can be quite top heavy, but we have people from the most junior interns all the way up to senior leaders. Everyone is invited. People all grades of seniority come and celebrate one another, regardless of what team they're in. It's wonderful.
Oh, congratulations. That just sounds wonderful. Okay. So, you know, wanted to cap off our last question just to talk about, you know, equity and women in technology. You know, I read some data around the proportion of women employees in UK tech, in UK tech, and it's declined for the first time in 5 years by just over 2%. The study reveals that only 15% or under 15% of IT directors are women. So last year, I interviewed a colleague of mine here in Canada, Doria Manuka-Daka, and she told me that the glass ceiling for Black women was made of concrete. I spoke to someone else who said, you know, and so what that means is you're not, if it's concrete, if it's glass, you can see representation. If it's concrete, you're not going to see any representation, right? Correct. I mean, it just, it's terrible. When I heard that, it really awaken something in me around how I can support building diversity in tech. But, you know, maybe you could share what you believe companies and organizations could do to support building diverse workforces.
I will say that I definitely do agree that the decline in women in tech is concerning. And I will say that the general lack of representation for Black women in tech in the UK is quite deeply concerning. Mm-hmm. So at any given level of seniority out of the wider technology sector, I believe Black women comprise 0.7% of the wider technology workforce. And so a tiny proportion of that, including myself, is more senior. So we can be talking single or double digits potentially in any given industry, which is quite alarming. But I do believe that it's a fixable problem. And there are a couple of things that organizations can and should do to be proactive. And I've tried to focus on measures that don't necessarily cost money. So organizations big and small, regardless of their budget, can implement some of these things. So I'll try to be quite practical here. So the first thing that anyone could really do is unconscious bias training. And that doesn't need to be really fancy. You don't necessarily need to bring in externals. Talk to your HR or similar teams about something simple they could do, because many hiring decisions are influenced by unconscious bias. Mm. And implementing even a simple training program can help to identify and address those biases, ensuring fair evaluation for all candidates. And I would encourage organizations to think through inclusive hiring practices. So that would include reviewing and adjusting their practices to attract a wider pool of talent. This could include using name-blind resumes, which we do in government, which is one of the things that I think we do well. You could try skills-based interviews so that you don't discriminate against career gaps, et cetera, or career returners. And having diverse interview panels where no two people share the same protected characteristics, which is another thing that we do in government, which I'm quite proud of. I would encourage organizations to look into mentorship and sponsorship for a range of underrepresented groups, including Black women. Mentorship programs connect women with experienced professionals who can provide guidance and support. Sponsorship programs take things a step further by actively advocating for women's career advancements. So it's a little bit more proactive and vocal and visible. I would encourage organizations to look into flexible work arrangements, which again is something that doesn't necessarily cost money and can have benefits to the bottom line if it helps you to retain elements of your workforce who might need to leave otherwise. So flexible working arrangements, whether that is remote working options or compressed hours, can make it easier for a range of people, including women, to balance work and personal commitments. Particularly, that's important for people with caring responsibilities. And I think one thing that's important to underscore here, if you're seeking to make the workforce better for any one person or group with protected characteristics, you're almost always going to have a net positive for your entire workforce.
Yeah.
So it almost works out better.
Yeah.
The last thing that I would say is about role models and visibility. So I would encourage organizations to do what we just said, have that celebration, make the wins visible, highlight successful women in technology roles internally or in your field to create visible role models and inspire the next generation of women in tech. This can be achieved either through internal initiatives, supporting external conferences and events that showcase women in tech.
I love it. Thank you all so much. We'll cut this probably as a separate segment because I love this just as an information opportunity for organizations and how they can improve and enhance and ensure that there's diverse voices, diverse thought, diverse ways we code, diverse ways we plan, diverse in everything we do. So I really appreciate it so much. And I appreciate you joining me here today, Elizabeth. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me, Leigh.
Thanks. And if you're interested in learning more about this video or others, please don't hesitate to hop on over to cio.com with the /UK. Thanks again.